Barry Dawes is back with us from Martin Place Securities for another weekly installment of Bulls, Bears and Brokers. Barry, you are a broker. You are also a trained geologist. So we're going to talk copper, talk about it from a few angles today.
Yes. Well, I think we've seen that gold is the thing that really drives our resources market, and that's on its way up, and the resources market's moving, and the iron ore prices help the big stocks. But it's really copper that I think is a very important driver for our market, and I think it's going to become more and more important over the next decade for us.
Copper does have renewed enthusiasm behind it. It is, of course, a classic base metal, but there's new applications given how much of it goes into electric vehicles, for instance. Talk to us about the growth trends.
Well, the best thing about copper is it's everywhere. And if we've got electricity, we've really got to have copper. And copper is just a wonderful, wonderful metal. And you can touch it and feel it, it looks great. But if we look at copper, it's the third largest metal in terms of after steel and aluminium. It's 23 million tonnes a year. And it's got this growth rate of 3.35% over the last 120 years. So it's just consistent. They're always finding new uses for it. And we're finding that the applications are just extraordinary, from the fact that they can use copper in hospitals to kill all the bugs, all the golden staph and so on. They're using it on surfaces, on all sorts of equipment and benches there. But so it's got quite a large range of uses. Now, with the advent of electric vehicles, we're finding that the demand in the transportation sector, and historically that's been about 13 or 14% of copper consumption. Now that could push it up to about 20% of total consumption. And if we find it really fascinating that, first of all, there's so much more copper used in the vehicle itself for all the electric motors and so on. And we all know that modern motor cars have got electric motors for everything, from windows to seats to windscreen washers, just everything. So there's a lot of copper, but a lot more will come through these electric vehicles. But it's not just in the vehicles itself. You've got to have all the infrastructure. That just means we're going to need more copper wires for distribution of the power, more generators, and on all the recharging facilities and infrastructure. So the demand for copper is going to maintain that 3.35% that it has over the last 120 years.
When we're talking about this demand and indeed supply, what are some geographical trends? Is it still flowing in the same directions regionally and globally?
Well, like most things, China takes about half of the copper consumption, and that just keeps growing. And you can appreciate that if that's growing at 5 or 6% per annum for half, that gives you most of your 2% for the 100% of copper consumption. So China's important, but overall, with India becoming more significant, we've got over 65% of copper consumption from Asia. So I keep on saying to people, you know, we've got 1,400 million people in China, and 1,300 million in India, 800 million in ASEAN, and lots more. So that's really where we should be focusing on the growth, and not so much Europe or the United States. So the demand just going to continue, and that's very important to understand.
Tell us more about the outlook for consumption.
Well, we can focus on OECD, or we can focus on the US or whatever, but at the end of the day, we've got to continue to focus on China. Now, the China, to me, is in this major expansion, which has got many years to run. India's coming up, and that will mean that the overall demand might even accelerate. These are really important things to understand. So the demand for copper is just going to continue to grow.
And what is Australia's role in all of this? How are we poised, maybe with opportunities or threats versus other suppliers and consumers?
Look, Australia is an important supplier of copper to the world. It might only be 4 or 5%, but there's really quite significant growth potential. We've got one of the world's largest copper deposits in Olympic Dam, and that's only running at a very small proportion of its resource. So it's got the capacity to be much, much bigger. And South Australia is talking about having 2 million tonnes of copper production per annum by about 2030. Now, at the moment, we're only about a million. So to have another probably 1.5 million tonnes coming out of South Australia is pretty exciting. But there are many opportunities there. But there are lots of other fun things that I think are happening in Australia on the exploration scene. South Australia is probably the place that you really need to focus. Olympic Dam is there, and that extraordinary Oak Dam West discovery that BHP has made has brought a bit more focus on there. But we've got the Torrens joint venture. Its program is underway, so that could be very exciting. There's another half dozen juniors there, which I think are very, very exciting. We're going to see a lot of action. But the other area which is of particular interest is up in the Paterson province of Western Australia, up around Telfer. Now, Rio has found something really quite extraordinary. They haven't told us yet, but the whispers are that it is something quite extraordinary. Great Land Gold has found something quite extraordinary as well. It's a bit deep, but it's fascinating. And we've got Fortescue up there looking at it, and we've got a range of little companies that are carrying out exploration. We're going to hear a lot more about the copper in those two areas, South Australia and Western Australia. But we've got to keep in mind here in New South Wales, it's pretty exciting. We've got a number of opportunities. We've got the Cadia produces 100,000 tonnes of copper, so that's a fairly significant producer, and I think we're going to see a lot more over the next decade. It's not going to be near-term stuff, but over the next decade as discoveries are made and developments are expanded.
Thank you for naming those tips you did. I'm wondering if I can press you for any more smaller companies or projects here in Australia, especially on the exploration side, that are coming to you as an investment.
Well, look, there's about a dozen companies, actually there are more than a dozen, and I really don't like talking about individual things. I guess the one stock I have spoken about recently was Kirkland Lake, and which has just done extraordinarily well, and still most people don't have that in their portfolio. I think that they should, but that's gold. But we've got this extraordinary bull market that's underway, which is going to run for 15 years. So there's going to be plenty of opportunity for people. Do note that the China market was up nearly 4% yesterday. And that long-term uptrend that I show is still intact. And that market will go to a new high in this global bull market.
Well, let's bring it back to the bottom line. What are your price projections moving forwards for this commodity?
Well, copper at the moment is just trading under $3. In my channel analysis, I see prices well over $4 over the next couple of years. So that's going to be very, 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 very strong for all the copper producers, the Rios and the BHPs, and the Newcrests and the Oz Minerals and so on. So it's going to really underpin our big stocks, and so that myriad of small stocks I think will perform very well under that umbrella.
Barry Dawes, thank you very much.
Thank you.